Okay, let's keep it rolling. Media companies, both large and small, are always tasked with expanding, reaching new audiences, and this next Sportsfronts presenter has done an amazing job embracing the ever-changing digital media landscape to reach fans wherever they are. So up next, we're going to hear from ESPN executives and on-air talent about how they go about identifying and programming for new audiences. First, we're going to shoot a quick video.
Everyone ready? Are the Bills ready? I'm
ready. Ready?
Yeah.
Dude, obviously.
We're good?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Where should we start?
How do I feel? It's been a long journey.
Nothing great in life has ever been accomplished without enthusiasm.
It's like the room just cleared of smoke.
Look for the hurry up.
We got it, Bill. We've already been over.
Right now, for all those who are still in that hospital, there's your wave.
I do whatever I need to do to win. If you don't want to live that regimented mentality to win, then you don't need to be alongside of me.
Who says I can't?
Nobody!
Who says I can't?
Nobody!
Yeah!
I am here tonight to honor a remarkable woman who believed that everyone has something to contribute.
We all came to see you.
I like that.
Yeah.
Pete likes that.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
So. I'm from Nepal and I'm in the USA now because of golf.
I wanted to go to school. I didn't want to be a normal person. I wanted to be the champ.
As you know, there's time in life. It's the most precious thing we have.
I know who you are!
Kobe is Kobe, and I'm LeBron. You know, I gotta do what I gotta do.
Facts, talk your young blood.
I'm labeled the biggest boss.
One thing I hate in life is the boss himself.
He's created a yoga that has helped thousands of people and that has hurt and destroyed thousands of lives.
You have to survive. It's about surviving.
How many of you are holding on? 13.
And the Emmy goes to SC Feature.
And the Emmy goes to E60.
The Oscar goes to OJ Made in America.
Hello, everyone. I'm Carrie Flynn. I'm a reporter at Digiday, and I have the lovely opportunity to sit down and chat with ESPN, who I'm sure you're all familiar with, but I know you just watched an awesome sizzle reel of like the new stuff that they're really working on, and that's what we're here to talk about today, reaching new audiences. I want to have the panelists introduce themselves, if they don't mind.
Laura Gentile, SVP of Marketing at ESPN.
Mina Kimes, I'm a senior writer at ESPN.
And I'm Connor Schell, Executive Vice President of Content at ESPN.
Awesome. So I was here earlier this morning. We had the pleasure of listening to Bleacher Report's CEO. And there was just one point that interested me and struck me. He said, without naming, he said blank, aka ESPN, is looking to replace the decline in linear. We're looking to build a social media platform. I'm hoping we can start there. When we're talking about reaching new audiences, when you guys think about that, is that essentially just, like he said, implied, replacing a decline in linear, or is it really about something more? Connor, if you want to start.
I think it's absolutely about something more. I mean, I think we've thought and this company has always been founded on the notion of we are reaching audiences wherever they are and wherever they're interacting with sports. So now that has meant for us over the last several years, thinking about how our brand exists and what we can create across social platforms, launching our new service ESPN Plus so that we can have a complementary sports service in the over-the-top environment, thinking about how we're presenting our programming and our content and our storytelling across platforms to reach and engage new audiences.
Yeah, I don't think we've ever looked at it as an either or. Yeah. You know, we have a linear platform that has massive, massive reach. That's a good thing. And we're continuing to grow all our digital assets and social. And so we definitely don't look at it as an either or. We look at be everywhere we could possibly be to reach fans.
And like you said, that's been in the strategy for a while now. There wasn't a particular moment that caused the change.
No, not
at all. I mean, listen, we take a lot of pride in being an innovative company that's been out ahead of launching and existing new platforms for a really long time.
I think I can speak to it almost as a fan in some ways, which is how I came to ESPN. I was a business journalist who excessively tweeted about sports, and that's how ESPN found me. And I consumed ESPN, I consumed linear, I consumed the games, but I also lived on social media, tweeting about sports, building a community around sports on social media. And I think most fans now are similar to how I was in that they're watching ESPN, but they're also, you know, living on the internet, living on Twitter, Instagram, everywhere else, and talking about it there, and they want to be reached in both of those ways.
Great. Awesome. Well, so we're coming off of a lot of big, I mean, there's never a dull moment in the season. There barely are seasons these days. So we have the NFL draft, the NBA draft, we're heading into NBA free agency. When you guys, and Connor specifically, when you kind of like plan how you address these moments, are there particular platforms that you gravitate to depending on the sport and the moment, or is it pretty diversified throughout the year?
No, I mean, it is pretty diversified throughout the year. It's pretty diversified every single day. I mean, the luxury of having the platforms and the reach we have and our touch points with audiences is we are thinking about how to sort of attack the sports calendar, and we have the luxury of most of the events in sports are calendarized across every platform. And so you think about, you mentioned the NFL draft, just taking that one specifically, we can think about all of our lead up programming across television and digital, but then for the draft itself, we, in this case, this year, thought about three different discrete presentations reaching different audiences on different platforms across ABC, ESPN, and with a live show on Twitter. And I think what I was particularly proud of with the presentation of that event was each one of those broadcasts, they were tailored specifically to who they were trying to reach. Yeah. And all took the same event and put their own spin on it, and I thought it really worked. I thought what Mina was able to do on Twitter was really brilliant and was very different than what our approach was on ABC or ESPN.
Yeah, Mina, could you tell me a little about that? I was telling you earlier that I watched the debate last night on Twitter, but that's very different because what I watched is the exact same of what was on television last night. So I'm curious from your perspective, I understand like you guys do completely different programming from what's live on Twitter versus what's live on linear.
Yes, exactly. It's a kind of a second screen experience. We are experimenting with a lot of formats and shows on Twitter right now. We've got Hoop Streams, which is a huge success, and that was a pregame show during the NBA playoffs. We're doing pregame, postgame. Basically, we're trying to find out or figure out, okay, when are people on social media talking about sports, and when do they want to watch other people talking about sports and have a conversation? What are the best moments for that? There's really, in my opinion, no better moment for that than drafts, right? Because if you guys are like me and you're an insane football fan, you are on Twitter during the draft. You are looking for reactions. And I think the benefit, Connor spoke about how it's not exactly the same programming. It's not duplicative at all. It's a very different tone. It's a different cast. It's a different style. And that's not just like putting up our youngest people and, you know, hello, fellow kids. Like, it is actually very much, it's different in a lot of ways. Because I do a lot of our linear programming and I talk about football on those. But on Twitter, I think we have the freedom to not only be analytical and go deep because we have the time on things, but also show our passion and authenticity and show how much, like, I love the draft, I geek out on it, and when I'm on Twitter talking about it, I feel comfortable doing that.
You feel comfortable freaking out about Daniel Jones.
Yes, that is, if he's great, that will very much haunt me. Apologies to all the Giants fans in the crowd. But it's 45 minutes of analysis on Daniel Jones and 5 minutes of freak out, and that's what people on Twitter want, because they're freaking out about, if you're a Giants fan, you were probably in your living room having a meltdown if, you know, you knew anything about football. But, and you were probably watching me having a meltdown, and we're having a meltdown together, and that's really fun.
Oh, sorry, go ahead, Laura.
Yeah, no, and to expand upon the different production aspects, you know, when you look at what we did on ABC, yeah. It was very, very different than what we did on ESPN, and it was very different than what we did on Twitter, and fans get that. You know, we look at these things, post and pre, and after the draft was completed, you know, fans are like, I get it. You know, the telecast on ABC was much more about storytelling and backstory and the notion of the journeys that these athletes have taken with their families. ESPN was much more analytical and X's and O's, and it was, you know, hardcore football, which you've learned to love. And together, it was an awesome case study for us in that everything grew. You know, it was our most watched draft ever, and 46% of the audience was women. And it's so interesting, like the NFL draft, I think the legend goes, 30 years ago, we rung up the NFL and said, hey, we want to televise the NFL draft, and they were like, why? It's a business meeting, like, that's so boring. And then here you go, fast forward, and 46% of the audience is female, but...
Are you saying the audience on linear, the audience overall?
Yeah, overall.
Oh, overall.
Yeah,
okay.
And the notion of 600,000 people converging on Nashville in the rain to just be a part of the draft, like, it just has taken on a whole new cultural relevance, and it's just awesome that we're a part of it.
But the point, and to build on that point, about, and you know, make this about reaching new audiences, as Laura said, it was all additive, yeah. Right? It was all, the ESPN telecast grew, the ABC telecast grew year over year, and the show we did on Twitter reached big number of new viewers. And that's, you know, I mean, that's an exciting outcome for us, because it proved a thesis that by thinking about how you present this different places, you can actually lift the whole thing. It's not, you're not dividing it all out the same group of people.
Does it at all differ though between the sports? Like, I guess, like, you're talking about drafts, right? So NFL and NBA, Twitter is really helping increase that audience. But when you think about reaching these audiences and reaching them on platforms, do you at all consider like, oh, like NFL people are super into, I don't know, for example, like Snapchat, or an NBA people are maybe super into Twitter?
We absolutely consider that and think about how we gear different resources towards covering these sports. You know, but I think generally the thesis of we want to be present in people's lives. We want to be present in their lives when they're talking about consuming, thinking about sports, and we're trying to drive avidity, because this is all. I mean, you were joking with me backstage about competitors and stuff. Like, this is truly all a rising tide for us. The more sports fans there are, the better it is for our consumption. And wherever people become sports fans is good for the business we're in every single day. Because ultimately, if you find out that Kemba Walker is interested in signing with the Boston Celtics from a tweet that Adrian puts out, you're going to come back to our shows, to our platforms for a deeper level of analysis, and ultimately you'll come back after he signs, and you'll come back to watch the games. And that's a really good ecosystem for us to exist in, and we're really happy about kind of our place in it right now.
Yeah, sounds awesome. Well, one format we haven't touched on yet but I want to talk about is podcasts. Because when you talk about growing your audiences, I'm curious, with podcasts, is it really reaching new audiences, or really just adding more value to the fans that already watch TV? I don't know if, Mina, you're able to say, as someone who is part of the podcast programming, what you understand about the fan base there.
I have found that most people who listen to podcasts also consume everything else, radio, TV. I came up, my first sort of job at ESPN, aside from writing, was in radio. And it's been interesting, because there are a lot of similarities between podcast and radio. It's the same thing. People want to spend time with you. The difference is, with radio, with traditional radio, you have a sort of an onus to talk about the news of the day and the sports of the day. And with podcasts, you can go deeper instead of broader. You can connect, I think, very, very closely with a very specific audience. And obviously, I'm sure a lot of you guys in here listen to podcasts. You like having the opportunity to pick and choose who you're spending time with and what you're listening to. And if you're doing that, you probably are listening to a bunch of different things, right? It's not, no one who subscribes to my podcast only listens to my podcast. I can guarantee that. So I think it's
only podcast.
Yeah, well, maybe my mom probably only listens to my podcast. But yeah, I think it's entirely additive, and I think it's nice. It's like a nice buffet for people to choose from.
Awesome. And I guess kind of from the programming side too, I feel like we've, at the same time, maybe arguably reached like, I don't know, peak podcasts. There are a lot of podcasts these days, but ESPN overall is producing a lot of them. Is that just kind of same thing, like hitting fans or in particular sports or maybe who are interested in particular personalities like Mina?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a strategy that we've been thinking about a lot over the last, year or two is how do we continue to build our presence in that space? We understand where digital audio consumption is going. And as I said before, like we want to be there if fans are consuming and talking and thinking about sports. It is a unique environment in that, as Mina said, we can launch some very niche shows there and they can find very, direct audiences who are interested in maybe only that person's point of view or the particular subject matter. So we do have a wide array of shows in the space. We have some that particularly pop, like Mina's, Zach Lowe's podcast on the NBA has been really successful. What Matthew Berry and Stefania Bell and Field Yates do in fantasy sports has been really successful for us. And then, we use it as a platform to allow personalities and talent on our air to also just sort of expand their repertoire.
But that's something else we've also debated, right? It's sort of like, should we do more podcasts and reach, more diverse audiences and niche audiences, or is less is more? And we've debated that. And
right.
To your point, though, netting out where you actually have a podcast called Around the Rim for women's basketball, it's found its audience. It's not enormous, but it's found an audience and we're serving an audience. So I ascribe to the notion of more is more. And ideally we reach lots of different sports fans.
Awesome.
Right.
Yeah, sticking to you, Laura, I guess I'm curious, we've talked to obviously a lot of platforms on the content side. When it comes to your role at the company in marketing, are there particular platforms that you guys gravitate to more than others? Or like you just said, is it pretty like even in terms of where you're investing your time and also your dollars?
Yeah, I mean, we look at it all. I mean, I think there's certain things, whether it's a big brand campaign or huge events like NBA Finals, where we just want to be everywhere. And there's other things that are, much more specific and much more tactical. But we look at the whole mix. I mean, I think for us, as we are looking at our future, more and more about, of course, being where fans are, but taking bigger swings, promoting perhaps fewer things, but putting a lot more weight behind them. So we're really looking at all of our properties and figuring out, what's going to drive the greatest audience, what's going to drive the greatest affinity to our brand, what's going to be the most relevant. But we look at it all. I mean, even this year, we're going to look at the Ocho a little bit differently, which is something, we created out of thin air, super funny, at least in my opinion. And we haven't really promoted it.
Can you tell us more about what that is?
So, the Ocho came out of, ridiculous Will Ferrell movies. But the notion of, pretend sports actually becoming sports. And so we have a full day of programming of things like cornhole and, can jam and just fun things that you do that at the end of the day aren't maybe technically sports but are super fun and competitive and just silly. And so it's just something that we've created and fans love it, and we're going to go to a couple beaches in Miami and in LA and just sort of come on upon people and watch them playing their sports and then actually film it as if it was a real sport. But it's just one of those, we call them brand gems, whether it's the Little League World Series or the Ocho or the Spelling Bee, little things that fans love that we want to promote and nurture a little bit more in addition to the NFL Draft and the NBA Finals and massive sporting events.
I would like an invite to Miami. That sounds like a blast. Let me know.
We'll see how this goes.
So we heard from the UFC this morning, and I will admit, I don't watch much of UFC, but I've been fascinated by its growth, and especially at ESPN. I had recently wrote, I think, last month about you guys have a new Snapchat show, and it's specifically about MMA content, which I watched a lot of it, learned a lot. It was great. Walk me through about your guys' investment in that type of coverage and seemingly across all your platforms, from television to your app to Snapchat, Connor.
So, I mean, obviously this year started a long-term relationship that we now have with the UFC, primarily driven by the content on ESPN Plus, where we are the home of their events, right? And so we've been really tried to be really thoughtful about, okay, how do we build the infrastructure of content around that and do what ESPN has always done to entertain fans, inform fans, help build characters in the sport, help connect with people, and again, help a sport that has realized really tremendous growth and has great momentum behind it still find new audiences on our platforms and other places. And look, I think we've done that with great success so far. It's you know, the UFC content, along with a bunch of other great rights portfolio, a great rights portfolio we put together, has been the backbone of what ESPN Plus has been so far, and it has worked. We have, as I said, you know, through Ariel Helwani, we're doing some great shows across social platforms. His show on Twitter and his podcast have been really successful for us to, again, engage with the hardcore fans, but also find new fans. And you mentioned the show on Snapchat. Like, we know that the UFC audience is really young. It's really diverse. We know that they're active across social platforms. And that show was a logical extension of what we've built on Snap and the audience that we've built there. And again, that's about engaging with fans and trying to get them excited about the sport and what they've already seen and what's coming up.
Awesome. I'm curious, like you just talked about, like you're putting some of that content exclusively as part of your ESPN Plus package. And so I know ESPN Plus is still kind of new, but it's a big part of your offering. I don't know if, Mina, I'd be curious to hear your perspective of like where you see, again, as being a fan before you joined ESPN, of like where you see ESPN Plus being a part of the ESPN community. Sure. And making sure, even though you're offering subscriptions, it's really available, the content that you guys provide is really available to your fans.
Yeah, well, obviously there's live sports. You know, if you're a fan of UFC soccer or something like esports, something niche, it's great to have a place where you can go and you know you can watch it and reliably watch it. But also we're experimenting with a lot of original programming and things like details. If you're a true sports nerd like me and you really want to watch Kobe or Peyton or someone much smarter than you break down a sport, I think that's like a perfect fit for that platform. It's just very intense, right? Like if you're an intense sports fan, it's nice to have a place like that. But it doesn't only live on ESPN Plus. Some of our programming there, you can find like Katie Nolan's show. She'll put stuff on YouTube and Twitter as well. And you know, you might want to interact with it there too. I think it's going to continue building probably in both of those directions. I mean, I'm not.
I don't know. Let her know eventually.
Answer that from a fan perspective. I like both of those things and consuming both of those things on Plus. So I'm always excited to see what comes up next.
I think it's just imperative, right? We have to be everywhere. We've kind of hit on that a bunch already in this conversation, but the notion of going direct to consumer is just sort of in this day and age, you have to provide that as well. So we've always looked at it as additive and creating more content there and original content there in addition to additional rights portfolio and putting rights there.
Yeah, for sure. One thing I've noticed, I guess, from your department is like, for instance, the Snapchat show, they'll talk about an upcoming like match and they'll be like, you can only watch it on ESPN Plus. So it seems like there's a lot of like, you guys is using your own and operated systems and also across social to kind of create this big ecosystem like Mina was talking about.
Yeah, and I think that goes back to where I sort of started around. Just if the filter is, we want people to be more avid sports fans. We want people to understand what's going on in the sports world, to engage with it, to think about it, to debate with their friends, to talk about it. Like, then our purpose is how do we seed these platforms with content that will get people excited about what's going on? Because again, a more avid sports fan, we really believe, is going to consume more ESPN, and they're going to consume more ESPN to get the deeper experience, to hear what Mina has to say, to think about, you know, our talent, our highlights, our rights, and then ultimately to watch the games, and that's the ecosystem we think about all the time.
One other part of the business I want to talk about is live events. So obviously there's sports like, you know, that you guys cover, which are obviously live events, but your own live events. Mina, I know I heard that you are now doing live podcasts. So we talked about the importance of podcasts. But you're kind of getting both. You're having not just people listening to you, but people being able to come to see you. Yeah. I guess I'm curious like what you think that offers.
It's funny, at like a digitally focused conference, right, we're talking about something that feels very old school, which is having a live event, people buying tickets and showing up. But it's something that we, and I think a lot of other places, have been doing more and more, and it's kind of gaining traction. I have an event in Seattle next month that I was convinced no one would come to, and it sold out, you know, right away. And I've done some of our other podcast events, and they've also sold out very quickly. There's clearly a strong desire for those. I think it stems from kind of what I was talking about earlier with podcasts, and I think some of our digital properties, which is the audiences are so specific and passionate and focused, right? Like I do, Around the Horn is probably the most popular show just by viewers. I do hundreds of thousands of people that time of day. And they love it, but you know, an Around the Horn show isn't gonna be as focused and passionate and specific, and you don't know your audience in the same way as when you do a podcast, or honestly, the Dan Le Batard show is probably the most passionate audience at ESPN. I feel comfortable saying that. They immediately sold out their live show. It was insane. Yeah. I mean, so I think it's funny how this like old school thing and these new digital things kind of go hand in hand, in that the audiences are very knowable and you're communicating with them more. You know who they are. More people come up to me at airports to talk to me about Le Batard and my podcast than anything else. And I think doing these live shows is a great way to connect with those fans and really identify them.
Yeah, I think that just all speaks to the passion of sports fans and how that's our job, is to tap into that passion. And so whether it's a live podcast or another type of live event, like we just did a concert on the roof at the South Street Seaport for game two of the NBA Finals. And more we're thinking about, let our fans in and let them come to our events and let them be a part of these experiences. At the NFL Draft, we had an ESPN house where we took over a honky-tonk bar and just opened it up to the public, which we've never done before. You know, in the past, perhaps we do an event and it was VIP only, or only for sales clients. And we're changing our mentality to say these events, these opportunities should be open to fans. Yeah. They should be able to watch the draft with us in Nashville. And they should be able to go and hang out at the NBA, you know, NBA Finals game and listen to a concert and then watch the game. So more and more, this is becoming kind of our recipe to connect with fans on a different level and have more personal interaction.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm curious what you said. It kind of seems like different lines. Some of them are more marketing and maybe, like you said, VIP, like, or fans, versus others, like you said, your event is ticketed. So there's both sides of the business there. Not necessarily that's where you're making the majority of your money, but you are essentially seeing it as not only marketing, but a revenue stream.
That knowledge is valuable. I mean, I think it's valuable. I think it's really valuable to actually see my audience face to face. The thing about social media is we actually now know them better than we ever did before. Maybe a little bit too much sometimes. But it's so valuable to have these events and meet them and talk to these people and hear what they like and hear what they don't like. And I don't think that's something we really had access to before.
At any particular moments that you learn that what people don't like or perhaps do?
Just look at my mentions.
Read my comments.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I guess I'm curious to hear a little bit more about kind of what ESPN's priorities are going forward. I know you can't tell me everything, but you touched on a little about not necessarily just football, but unique sports like cornhole.
That's a priority per se.
But Connor, is there anything else kind of that you're focused on when it comes to type of coverage going forward and also investments in platforms going forward?
Good question. I mean, I think the key priority for us, and we haven't talked about a lot here, is you know, our core programming on network and on platform, both digital and you know, television, continuing to work every day to make sure that that's great and that it engages fans, it entertains them, it informs them, and that we tell great stories, right? And that's a huge part of what we do every day. I think then once we've sort of feel really, you know, as we feel really good about that, we're also thinking about, right, how do we build these direct to consumer touch points, right? And that can be via, you know, in obviously we've talked a lot about ESPN Plus as a way to start that journey, complementary to our core offering, but something that we're growing, investing in, and building. And then as Laura and Mina were just touching on, like, direct to consumer can also mean a live podcast. It can also mean a presence on site places. It means a different level of interaction with your consumers. So we think about that a lot as a priority. you know, our third big priority right now as we look to the future is reaching new audiences, right? That, like, literally everything we're talking about on this panel, how do we think about reaching fans on Snapchat, reaching fans on YouTube, reaching fans on Twitter, and then, again, that being part of what the fan journey is today. Like, the fan journey is a little bit different than it was when we had a magazine, a radio network, and a desktop site, right? That's what being present in fans' life meant 10 or 15 years ago, and obviously it's evolved. So how do we reach new audiences to creativity, to showcase the things we're doing? You know, shows like Hoop Streams that Mina talked about, like, that was a really successful, effectively pregame show that we did on social platforms throughout the NBA season and then in the NBA Finals. And really what we were trying to do there was create great content for fans, but navigate them to watch the games, yeah. Right? And so reaching new audiences is really important. And then the base of how we think about all these things is just continuing to, are we innovating, right? And is innovation kind of core to our culture,
yeah.
Whether it's, you know, producing SportsCenter or producing a show off platform or coming up with a new marketing initiative. Like, are we trying to think about where the world's going and how we can get there?
Yeah.
I mean, Laura, you should jump in and add to all of that.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think the audience, you know, reaching new audiences always sounds kind of fancy, but like when we get down to it, it's really youth and women and Hispanics. And so when we think about that, you know, we're certainly thinking about like how young can we go in terms of our messaging. Certainly want to talk to the 18 to 25 year olds, but I'm of the opinion we should be talking to 10 year olds and just getting them familiar with ESPN and starting to love our brand, because that's sort of what happened to us. I mean, I started watching SportsCenter when I was really, really young, and I'm a lifelong sports fan. So we haven't really had that conversation about getting that much younger until recently, and we're a part of the Walt Disney Company, and like, who talks to kids better than the Walt Disney Company? So yeah. Youth is a huge emphasis, and then as we talked about even with the NFL draft, you know, women as sports fans, it's just a huge untapped audience to a degree. I mean, we reach 80 million women every month, but the fact of the matter is there's so many women out there that we can even serve even more deeply. And so, we dabbled in that for years, and then we started something called ESPNW, and now the entire company is really fixated on how do we grow this audience, and there was no better example than Robin Roberts hosting the draft on ABC, and like, oh boy, a lot of women tuned in.
Right.
So, you know, we're definitely evolving in our thinking, and it's such a big opportunity for us.
Yeah, I get a lot of female fans, or just feedback from female listeners, and I think, you know, yes, there's many different ways to connect with women and expand that audience is obviously a key priority for us. One of them is just putting women on our television shows.
Like you, or in commercials. Or in commercials.
With my dog. In traditional roles, right? There's nothing different about what I'm saying. I mean, it is different, but like the nature of it is still analytical and it's X's yep. and O's driven, but I'm just me. And I think as that's become normalized at the network, increasingly, female fans are tuning in. They're like, "Oh, okay, great. She looks like me."
Yeah,
and it's nice. Honestly, it's really refreshing.
Awesome. I think we're out of time, and that's a lovely note to end on. So thank you guys so much, and enjoy the rest of your conference.